Yes.
What's the outlook on the fund over the next 6 to 9 months?
That's a great question, Melanie. You know, the Amvona Fund, it just turned out, you know, the name, as you mentioned, it means pulpit. And I never knew when I got involved in this that by speaking about finance, it would give me access to such an enormous audience. I mean, it's just blown my mind completely. I've been able to, by God's grace, I've been found worthy, I guess, unworthy though I am, to speak to people all over the world. And, you know, for me, the Amvona Fund is really little more than just a way to demonstrate the ideas I'm talking about. Because what would it really mean, right, if you couldn't prove your point? I mean, when I first got in this, I remember thinking, boy, you know, every guy on Wall Street thinks he's smarter than everyone else in the market. And surely I'm just one of them. But I thought, you know, I'll just write my ideas down and I'll publish them. I thought the writing was terrible. I said, let me just publish it anyways. And that way I'll be outed, not as somebody having any ability, but just another person who thought he could beat the market. And that was, you know, 7 years ago, and 140 essays later, here I am, and I'm still writing out in great detail everything, every single thing I do, or speaking about it on the radio or on TV. There's really no regard for stealing ideas. I don't mind at all. People can ride my coattails. That's fine. But to your question, what the outlook is, you know, when you're allocating capital, there's a huge difference between speculation, which is typically associated with the nomenclature of trading, and real investment. I mean, in the parable, I said, hold on to this idea about the master being gone for a long time. I mean, he didn't say, I'll be back next week, get on your E-Trade account. You know, if you go down the Forbes 400, I mean, just look at the first 10 names, right? I mean, these are not people with a huge number of investments that they're dancing in and out of. You know, you've got the Mars family, the Zuckerberg family, Ellison, Gates, the Waltons, of course. I mean, it's like one investment that they've held for a really long time. But it was a good investment. And so, you know, in my mind, you know, there's an old saying that as activity goes up, returns go down. In my mind, it may sound like a cliche, but really the long-term horizon is what counts. And I hope in those annual reports what comes through is that, you know, we're buying securities at a price that's demonstrably below their intrinsic value. And that does two things, by the way, right? So it inherently protects principal. And then secondarily, it's very likely it's going to lead to, you know, better than average results. And that sort of just flies in the face of this common mythology that you have to take higher risk to get greater returns. And when you translate that to real estate terms, everyone gets it. And, you know, I'm always amazed, you know, my own community, the Greek community, I mean, some Greeks have it in their DNA, Lebanese too. It's something about understanding this principle. And they'll do it in real estate all day long, which, by the way, real estate is difficult to deal with because it's illiquid. There's high transaction costs. It's hard to get high rates of return. But they'll get it right away. Look, if that commercial building costs $1 million to build and I can buy it for $500,000, I've protected my principal. I'm probably going to get a good rate of return. But for some reason, when that's transferred to the market for public securities, it disappears. It's the weirdest thing. You know, the great economic author Fred Shrewd, in his classic, Where Are the Customer's Yachts, once said Wall Street is a weird place. I mean, it's the only place where people pull up in a Rolls Royce to get advice from people who take the subway home. You know, really intelligent businessmen will go to the public markets for securities and all of a sudden lose their business acumen. But the idea really is to try to find productive assets, presumably when you can buy them on sale, where there's really, first and foremost, you're seeking to protect principal, and then the returns will follow. And in this next 6 to 9 months, I'm fairly confident we'll be proven right in a big sort of way with our current commitments. And that's why every report, I mean, it's a small fund, but you know, we've got a 70-page annual report. That's maybe excessive, but the reason is really to be didactic, to sort of point that out. I mean, if nobody ever invests in that fund, I would be fine with that. But if they get something from it that allows them to think a little bit more clearly about how to handle their own capital, you know, I sleep better at night. That's really, in my mind, that's success. So, long answer to a short question. Yeah, John.
Sure. Do you keep a list of sort of stocks that you think might, you know, come get to a price where they're attractive to you? And if you do have such a list, what industries do you think would be, you know, right for
Yeah, great question. So I don't think anybody knows where the market's going to go today or tomorrow, or next week or next year.
Well, they said most experts have predicted 10 out of the last 5 recessions.
I don't know. If somebody can predict recessions, they should be trillionaires.
Right.
But that having been said, you know, I mean, I think the macro perspective of guessing where markets go is a really tough business, if possible, if it's possible. I don't think it's possible, but if it's possible, it must be very tough. I think analyzing individual securities from the bottom up is pretty easy. And I mean, anybody could learn to read a balance sheet or a statement of cash flows or an income statement. And even if you're not familiar with accounting, most people get the basics in 30 minutes. If they dedicate any measurable amount of time to it on a weekly basis, they'd be experts in a month. But, you know, in terms of selection of securities, John, you know, when you're buying an asset, I mean, you're going to want to know something about the company for sure. I mean, there's qualitative issues and there's quantitative issues. So you're going to want to know something about the assets, buttressing the issue, and the financial performance of the company over a period of time, and then something about the company's products, its management team, and so forth. I would always say stay in a circle of competence. Stay with companies or industries you know something about. You can broaden your circle of competence and learn about other industries, but I think there's great risk jumping into whatever the spirit of the times might be advocating. I mean, if you're looking to CNBC for advice, I don't think it's going to end well. I mean, people, you know, and I'll just say one of the great challenges to allocating capital is that, you know, most people really have a deep fear of being apart from a crowd. I mean, it's just human nature. You know, fish swim in schools, cows and sheep go in herds. Most people don't feel comfortable being apart from a crowd. And in the investing world, that is not a good thing. You know, there's some people who really, it doesn't bother them at all. I mean, I often say some of the greatest investors out there, there's a part of their mind that's miswired. I mean, it's not in any other context a virtue in their personhood. But when it comes to allocating capital, the fact they feel nothing or don't mind being apart from a group or even against a group is really works well in allocating capital. But, you know, I mean, I think every judicious investor who studies securities carefully, they know about a lot of companies. They're following things. And, you know, patience is really a virtue in that sense, because if you're willing to wait till prices come down, they do all the time. I mean, I think markets are very expensive right now. You know, there's cycles to markets, just like there's cycles to business. We just don't know when they change. But, you know, when you start to look around and prices are going up every day, like, for example, since the election, there's hardly a day that goes by where markets don't hit a new high. And then people start to say, well, this time's different, you know. And we start to hear that, I'd be very scared. So, yeah, Dave.
Father, thank you very much for inviting such a great group of people here.
Glory be to God.
And the other aspect too, this quote from Matthew really touched me tremendously. I think all of us certainly need to take advantage of the talents that God gave us.
Yeah.
But for a portfolio question,
sure.
You know, I see that right now your current portfolio is somewhat concentrated.
Sure.
Is that typical or atypical?
Yeah.
And in a certain respect, especially when you're holding the Apple, which is something that a lot of people follow. Can you maybe go in a little bit more depth in terms of this whole idea, in terms of this concentration of name? Is it typical or is it not typical? Or is it, you know, I mean, once again, you have a broad spectrum in terms of the way you invest.
Sure.
And I'm wanting to get a better understanding in terms of your philosophy from that standpoint.
Yeah, great question, Dave. You know, if you've known me long enough, you've probably heard me say, you know, diversification is a cover for not knowing what you're really doing. Now, that's probably too harsh, frankly, because some diversification probably is good. But, you know, when I see somebody's portfolio and I see 100 stocks in it, and I say, well, how do they possibly know a lot about each of those companies? And, you know, I gave the example of the Forbes 400. You just go down the list. I mean, their diversification comes down to one investment, frankly. I mean, Bezos is now number 2, right? And it's just Amazon. Zuckerberg, I think, is 3. It's just Facebook. You know, I don't agree with everything Warren Buffett says or does, and I'm not endorsing a lot of it, but he is pretty experienced, and he's got a lot of wisdom, and reading his reports is valuable. And, you know, he jokes one time at a point, he says, you know, you actually can't have, you can't, you know, people say you can't have, you can have too much of a good thing. He says, you can't have too much of a good thing. So, you know, if you're buying a security and you know, you've got this sort of proverbial dollar bill for 50 cents and you know what you're doing, you're sure of what you're doing, your reasoning's correct, you know, act on it. And because really great investments don't come along that often, to be frank with you. You know, we have this large investment in geospace technologies. And I've looked like I've been wrong all along. It's been 2.5 years. I mean, there's a tremendous downdraft in the oil and gas space that's been going on. You know, for 2 years, I'm saying, well, we're going to get 10% of this company. I mean, that's going to reverse eventually. And, you know, when you're looking at investments A, B, C, and D, your portfolio, and A and B are demonstrably better investments than C and D, I couldn't just allocate to C and D just for the sake of diversification. It would just be hard for me to do. You know, ideally, you should have 10 or 15, maybe, good positions in a portfolio, but finding 10 or 15 great companies on sale that are highly productive, hard to do. I mean, if you find one good idea in a year, I think you're doing pretty good. So I hope that answers the question. And then on Apple, you asked about Apple. You know, when we were buying Apple, I'm almost embarrassed that we did so well on Apple. I mean, it was just so obvious. I mean, I was embarrassed to tell our investors we had made so much money on it. But at the time, I mean, in 2013, Apple stock price had collapsed 44% in 6 months from the fall of 2012-2013. And if you read the media headlines, I mean, you would just think that everyone in China was going to own a Samsung Galaxy phone in 6 months. And everyone in America, for that matter, too, and that Android was where it was at. But, you know, as I really looked into it, I listened to what the CEO of the company was saying, Tim Cook, and I went to the stores, and I talked to managers, and I talked to customers, and I bought a bunch of Apple products. And I said, wait a second here, that's crazy. I mean, these people are crazy loyal to this brand. Nobody's switching to Android. If anything, the people were switching from Android to iOS. And at that time, I mean, Apple had no debt. They weren't paying a dividend yet, and they had this enormous free cash flow. And I thought, well, that's like an annuity. If nobody leaves, they're setting up a long-term annuity. And the media was just trashing the company. And it lost. How does a company lose, honestly, $300 billion in 6 months? I mean, somebody had to be wrong, right? On the side of each trade, there's a buyer and a seller. They both can't be right, right? One guy's right, one guy's wrong. Somebody's buying when they shouldn't be buying. Somebody's selling when they shouldn't be selling. But once you figure out you're right, I mean, we acted on Apple in a big way, and we were right. I mean, it didn't take long to figure out that the media was totally wrong. You know, we have an epidemic in this country of fake and distorted media. When it comes to personal reputations, it can be devastating. But in the securities market, that can be your friend. They're going to cause great misunderstandings from time to time and permutations in price, you know, aka volatility. You shouldn't be afraid of that. You should use that as your friend. So, yeah, Chris. Almost none, frankly. I mean, I just, you know, I don't want to judge too harshly. I know a lot of nice analysts, but, you know, I think it's just a job for them most of the time. And I mean, some of them do good research, but they're not really enterprising, right? I mean, you can have passive investments. You can have enterprising investments. I mean, there's no question the activity of the Amvona Fund has been incredibly enterprising since its inception. So, and, you know, really to borrow a line again from Buffett, I mean, if I want investing advice, I look in the mirror, frankly. You know, aside from not being worried about being with the group, you know, I think the ability to think independently is hugely valuable when it comes to allocating capital. Yeah. There's Cornelius. Yes.
I understand that productive assets are where you go, but what if you're not in that situation? You're living paycheck to paycheck, or you're a subsistent farmer and founder. Would you recommend someone in that situation?
Yeah, so, you know, another thing I hear all the time is, look, just get a basic clear framework for investment policy, understand compound interest, understand future value. We didn't talk about future value, but basically, you know, someone could say, I'm going to buy a car for $30,000. And I say, no. If you could get what Berkshire earned on that, you know, 19.8% over the next 30 years, that car is like millions of dollars. And then so it's thinking about things in future value. If people can get their mind sort of around seeing things differently, they start to look at money totally differently. I mean, they look at debt differently. They start to say, well, there's really two things going on here, right? There's your cost of capital and there's your return on capital. And you'll find typically those who have achieved financial independence, they understand that really well. They understand compound interest. I mean, they know that their cost of capital has to be lower than their return on capital because the delta between the two is their income. But you're right. Very often people who think about a wage or a salary, they're not thinking in those terms. But what I tell people, Cornelius, is that it doesn't matter if you have $10. I mean, people say to me all the time, well, I don't have enough money to be an investor. I said, well, what do you mean? I mean, everyone has some money, right? I mean, the guy sleeping on the bench has some money. Everyone has some capital. It doesn't matter how much you have. It matters what you do with it, which is totally in harmony with the parable of the talents. If you have $10, I mean, you're going to do something intelligent with it, or you're going to do something unintelligent. You're going to say to myself, what's the cost of this capital and what's its future value and where can I get the highest rate of return on? Or you're not. I mean, it doesn't have to be $1 million. But once you begin to think in those terms, you're going to start to feel more free eventually. You're going to feel more independent financially, regardless of what the number of talents you have. And in this case, using the monetary use of the word. So. Yes, Barry.
How did Domino's get on your screen, and do you feel as strongly about it now as you have in the last few months?
Yeah, it's a good, great question. Thank you, Barry. Oh, thank you. It's not a popular analysis, by the way. I'm taking a lot of flack, as usual, in the media for that. But, I think amongst the short-selling community, first of all, let me just say, I don't like selling short. It's, first of all, very difficult to do. You always get short-term capital gains tax rate on it. And ideally, right, I mean, your biggest P&L line item is your tax expense. So my job as a fiduciary is to minimize tax expense for the investor. So in that capacity, if I can get long-term capital gains on everything, I have a responsibility to do that. So short selling is unfavorable from a tax perspective. And frankly, I mean, theoretically, you have unlimited liability. I mean, what if the Chinese government came along tomorrow and said, you know, we want to own Domino's Pizza? You know, it would be quite a risk to our position. But amongst the short selling community, there's this idea that you have to have a catalyst. You know, you'll see with some of the well-known names in the activist short selling space that they'll want to identify some impropriety in the accounting or something like that. Or you probably read about the drama with Valiant Pharmaceuticals and Mylan and all the accounting shenanigans that went along with that. I have a slightly different take on it. I mean, if you can find, and we did the same thing, of course, right? I mean, we were doing that in 2014 in the pharmaceutical space, long before Valiant came to light. We were talking about those problems and bringing them to light. But I don't think every time you short a company, you need a clear smoking gun catalyst. When we were shorting Skechers, for example, in 2015, you know, the thesis was basically, this is clearly irrational. I mean, the undulation around the product, Skechers hadn't changed, their products hadn't changed. But all of a sudden, people got really super excited about the company, and the company just exploded in price. But they didn't exactly become Nike overnight. Now, that's a company with real R&D. I mean, it's a first-rate company. Skechers is always a second-rate company. So, again, it's this sort of groupthink that can create a bubble, and all bubbles work the same, right? I mean, they almost universally take place in an environment of low interest rates, excessive borrowing, and general optimism, which is not rational. So there's a beautiful saying from John Kenneth Galbraith in his classic, The Crash of 29, that, you know, you're never... So incredulous is when you're most happy. So you can only imagine these sort of investors and Skechers, and now today Domino's, they're feeling great. I mean, the stock is up 1,400% in 10 years. It's outperformed Microsoft, Uber, Tesla, Google. You just go down the list of real technology, and they're billing themselves as a technology. But what's really changed? It's a pizza, for crying out loud. It's just an okay pizza. And you look at what's really the core problem there is you've got a CEO whose compensation is tied to stock price performance and not the creation of intrinsic and enduring value for shareholders. That, in my mind, is a major mistake in corporate governance, a major failure. The role of the CEO, like the board of directors, is to protect the interests of the shareholders who actually own the company. And this guy is taking enormous wealth out of that company because of share price and not creating any real value for the company. So I look at that and I say, well, you know, clearly it's a bubble. I mean, we've been in this uncommon monetary policy for 10 years. He comes into the company at the nadir of the stock market crash of 2009, shortly thereafter. He rides this thing up. He levers it to death with $2.6 billion in debt. He creates an enormous shareholder deficit. I mean, literally, a buyer of the common stock today is buying debt. But they have none of the security of a debt holder. They're not like a bondholder. And it's just unsustainable. I mean, I don't know if there's going to be a catalyst tomorrow or next week. They miss earnings or something. That could certainly happen. Maybe they won't. But in my mind, there's no question. Interest rates are rising. He's not going to be able to keep doing what he's doing, Doyle, at Domino's. And it has to have an end. They all do. And I don't think it's going to end well for the common shareholder. So, about the thesis of Domino's, I wouldn't pass up good short ideas because there isn't an immediate catalyst. I think that's a mistake. I think if you see something where there's no way intrinsic value can justify the price, act on it.
But how does it make your screen? How do you find something like that?
Well, you know, I spend a lot of time reading everything, and sometimes things just come across and you dig into them. And, you know, you can, I personally prefer to start with the qualitative factors. You know, what does the balance sheet say? I mean, people forget, why is it called a security? Because you need security, right? I mean, when you're buying a piece of a company, you know, it probably benefit the average investor to think about buying the whole company. So, I mean, people go and they buy a house and they'll spend, you know, months analyzing everything from the school system to the crime rates in the neighborhood to the crown molding in the kitchen. But they'll buy a stock and they'll ask almost no questions at all. I mean, I don't understand how the two are different. I mean, you want to know what you're buying when you buy something. And you, so I'll usually start with the qualitative issues. I happen to like reading financial statements. Not everyone does. And when you find something that's totally backwards and upside down, I mean, in the case of Domino's, you know, you've got debt almost inverse proportionate relationship one-to-one to a shareholder deficit and growing. You know, that's something worth looking into. So I probably came across it in some sort of screener or saw some sort of news headline. And I'll just confess, too, Domino's was the first place I worked when I was young. So it was a good place to work. I earned $4.90 an hour. At the time, that was minimum wage. But looking at Domino's as a security today, that culture of debt has really extended to the franchisees. So they'll boast about their international expansion. But if you look at the debt these guys are taking on to open these stores, and the earnings are just anemic. I mean, you just go on their homepage, you know, two large pieces for $7.99. I mean, how long is that going to last? And you know, what are they selling? They're selling, you can slap technology on anything and it sounds exciting. Oh, we're going to use technology. But if you read that thesis in the 2016 annual report, I don't see where that is a durable competitive advantage for the company. This is a company that characterizes itself as the pizza delivery company. They don't say, you know, the best quality pizza or the best tasting pizza. I mean, if we're going to have drones and autonomous vehicles delivering pizzas in 10 years, I don't know why Pizza Hut wouldn't be doing it too. I don't know why Chipotle wouldn't be doing it and everybody else, the local Chinese food restaurant. So, you know, that again is a in my mind, it's really a distortion. And, you know, you start to ask yourself, well, why is Doyle on Bloomberg and CNBC every day talking about this? And in my mind, I'd be frantic if I was leading that company. If my core competence, if I defined our company's success on something that was about to undergo a tremendous paradigm shift, and you know who's going to benefit? It's going to be the companies that develop this technology. It's going to be the Microsofts of the world and the Googles that really develop the technology. I mean, they're going to require a toll of everybody. That's in their financial interest. I'd be frantic too. I'd be wanting to know, what are we doing to stay on top of this? But that's an existential threat. That's not a durable competitive advantage. And I just don't know what, you know, who buys shares like that, where you're getting, you know, minus $42 a share in book value. You're paying almost $190 a share to get minus $42 in book value. I mean, that's just got to be the definition of insanity. Yeah, Dave.
Father, how do you reconcile your time between your work in terms of theology as well as investments?
Sure. Well, first and foremost, I'm a priest. That's my vocation. There's no question. And that's, I'm a very happy man. I feel satisfied. I'm one of the, one of those people that was fortunate enough to find what I was meant to be doing. And, but...
Matthew's very early in your life, in terms of figuring out...
Well, you know, I think for every priest it's different, you know, how they're called. It really is a calling in my mind. And in my life, it was an overwhelming calling. I mean, some people come to it slowly. Some people, for other reasons, perhaps. Maybe it's just a prudential decision they make over time. But for me, it was like a St. Paul experience. I was just knocked out one day by sort of this amazing light. And I was not exactly the church-going type. You know, I was a full-blooded, healthy, 18-year-old young man. I mean, going to church wasn't on my mind, frankly. I didn't even know what that meant. Would be a priest. What does that mean? You know. It was, I don't know, 17, 18 years later, I was ordained. It was a long journey. But I just didn't think the two were incompatible. I mean, I had this interest in security analysis and in public markets. And I've said it before, the bishop that ordained me, he just asked me these two very basic questions and sort of this Constantinopolitan rhetoric that you say, well, Father, do you have a family to support? I said, well, yeah, you know, I've got, you know, at the time I had three children. He says, does the church pay you? I said, no. I mean, I always just said, send me to the poorest church. You know, I don't care. Money was never a consideration. He just said, well, keep doing what you're doing. And I'm so grateful for that. I mean, I really have been blessed as a priest. I mean, There's the bishop that ordained me, and there's the bishop I have now. And I'll tell you, I'm really fortunate to be able to do the things I'm able to do it with the blessing of a bishop, and to have their love and their support, their prayers. I tell people all the time, especially young people, people will say, well, I don't know what I want to do. I say, well, I think you're asking the wrong question. You know, the question is, what are you meant to do? I mean, God has a purpose in our lives and a meaning for our lives. And when you find that, I mean, your energy levels will just be off the charts. I mean, you're never going to wake up in the morning and say, oh, God, I've got to go to work, or thank God it's Friday. I mean, when you hear people say that, you got to feel a little bad for them, because they're not really doing what they're meant to be doing. I mean, if you really love what you do, you're never going to say, what's the price? When you're meant to do, what I really, really, really mean is you're doing what God's calling you to do. And it doesn't mean the easiest thing, right? I mean, taking the shortest distance between point A and point B is very different than taking the right path. The right path is usually difficult, and this path has been difficult. There's room for tremendous misunderstanding, but it's also been very meaningful and filled with joy despite some of the challenges. So thank you for asking that question. Any other questions? Well, I guess that's it. Really, really a pleasure to come and speak to you guys tonight. Thank you so much. Thank you.